the genetic code?
Okay, an example is that if you have three nitrogenous bases arranged in A, U, G in this sequence, we can call it a triplet code. But on the mRNA, we call it a codon. So on the messenger RNA, it is a codon, AUG. And this codon always translates into amino acid methionine. And it is always like this, and because of this, we find this the genetic code is almost universal in all living organisms. Meaning that in our body, we AUG translates into methionine. In the cockroach in your kitchen, AUG also translates into methionine. So this is the table. Well, the good news for you is that you do not need to memorize the entire table. And I repeat, you do not require to memorize the entire table. Let me point out several things. As you can see here, AUG translates to methionine, and it is a start codon. Meaning that when translation occurs, it will look for AUG, this sequence. As long as the messenger RNA has this AUG sequence, then protein synthesis will start or will occur, and methionine will become the first amino acid in that protein. Or you can think about it this way. All protein, the first amino acid is always methionine. And then as the protein synthesis or the translation process come to an end, it will see one of the three UAA, UGA, or UAG. So as long as the messenger RNA has one of these three codons, then the translation process or the protein synthesis will stop. And remember, codon, we use the word codon on the messenger RNA, because we will have another term called anticodon, which is not on the messenger RNA, but it is on the transfer RNA, which is something that we'll talk about now. Transfer RNA transport amino acid to the ribosomes. So it carries amino acid to the ribosome so that the translation can start. Transfer RNA has a bud-like shape. I'll show you the picture in the next slide, how it looks like. But on the transfer RNA, one end of the transfer RNA carries an amino acid, and on the other end of the transfer RNA, it has something called an anticodon. The anticodon is also a triplet of three bases, and they are complementary, or they follow the base pairing rule with the with the codon on messenger RNA. So in other words, if the messenger RNA codon is AUG, what will be the anticodon? On the transfer RNA, if the codon on the messenger RNA is AUG, what will be the anticodon on the transfer RNA? So we can do the base pairing. Messenger RNA is A, so it will be U. U will be A. G will be C. So the anticodon on the transfer RNA will be UAC, because the codon on the messenger RNA will be AUG. So in here, the slide gives you another example. If the codon on the messenger RNA is CGG, then the anticodon high codon on the transfer RNA will be GCC. Then you will carry the transfer RNA. The transfer RNA will also carry the amino acid arginine. Let's double check with the table. So CGG on the messenger RNA. So C, and then G, that means in here, and then G. CGG will be arginine. So this is what I mentioned, the foot-like structure of the transfer RNA. The transfer RNA looks like a foot. On one end, it carries the amino acid. On the other end, it will have the anticodon. And this anticodon will match the codon on the messenger RNA. In other words, if the example here, this amino acid will be methionine, and then the anticodon here will be UAC. Ribosome and ribosomal RNA. So we talk about two types of RNA already. There are messenger RNA during the transcription, and the ribosomal, the transfer RNA, the foot shape structure that carries amino acid on one end and anticodon on the other end. Now we talk about ribosomal RNA and ribosome. They are closely related. First of all, ribosome. If you remember at the beginning of the semester, we have the cell structure and function lecture. What would be the function of ribosome? Ribosome, the function of it is to make protein. And we have the freely floating ribosome in the cytoplasm. And we also have ribosome attached to the rough ER on the endoplasmic reticulum. Because ribosome can attach to the endoplasmic reticulum, when we look at it under the microscope, it will make the endoplasmic reticulum rough. That's how we call it rough ER. Rough ER is the extension of the nuclear envelope. So the rough ER always like attached or the closest one to the nucleus. And the ribosome is made up of proteins and, most importantly, ribosomal RNA. RNA stands for ribosomal RNA. It means that it has something to do with ribosome. Because this RNA is made up of ribosome. And it has two subunits, small and large. So when the two subunits form get together, then the messenger RNA, if it is a messenger RNA, will go in between the two subunits. This is not a very good demonstration. So the two subunits, yeah, so it's like this. The messenger RNA will go in between the large and small subunit of the ribosome, like this. So it's certain the two subunits will join and form a ribosome just before the translation to occur. And I can tell you that immediately after the end of translation, they will be separated. On the ribosome, it has one binding site for messenger RNA, because as I told you that the two subunits will be like this, the messenger RNA will go in between the subunit. So the binding site is in between the subunit. And then we have three tRNA, we have three transfer RNA. We have three binding sites for the transfer RNA. The three binding sites of the transfer RNA, they are called A site, P site, and E site. We'll talk about those at the end of today's lecture. So basically, the messenger RNA, the binding for messenger RNA is for the messenger RNA to go in between the two subunits. And the three tRNA binding site is for the tRNA to go into the ribosome. So what it means here. So you have the two subunits of the ribosome. And the messenger RNA will go in between the two subunits. And then the tRNA is like a foot shape. It has an anticodon on one end, and it has the amino acid on the other end. As the ribosome move along or scan the messenger RNA, the new tRNA will keep on going into the ribosome. And as the new tRNA goes into the ribosome, it will bring in the amino acid. And the amino acid, they will be joined together to form a polypeptide chain. And here, imagine something called polyribosome. Polyribosome is basically on one piece of messenger RNA, you will not see only one ribosome. Usually, on a piece of messenger RNA, you have multiple ribosomes. The multiple ribosomes will bind to the messenger RNA, and each ribosome they will translate amino acid. They will also translate this into a polypeptide chain. So each ribosome will have a piece attached to it. In other words, all the ribosomes attached to the messenger RNA, they will simultaneously translate the polypeptide so that it will be faster and more efficient. And we call this polyribosome. Okay, you have a much better picture here to see my hand-drawn picture. So you can see the messenger RNA has the three binding sites for the tRNA, the A site, P site, E site here. You have the large and small subunit. And the pink strand here is the messenger RNA. And it fits in between the large and small subunit. As you can see that when the ribosome move along the messenger RNA, the tRNA will go into the A site, and then you bring in the purple amino acid, and then they will join to the previous amino acid chain, the polypeptide chain. And as the ribosome move along this messenger RNA, the polypeptide chain will get longer and longer. And this is the messenger RNA, and as you can see that in this electron microscope, and you can see that this messenger RNA, you have a lot of ribosome bind to it. We call it a polyribosome. So for translation, it requires three steps: initiation, elongation, and termination. Initiation and elongation requires energy, and termination does not require energy. We will talk about each step right now. Initiation. Basically, when initiation occurs, then everything comes together. Like the ribosome, they will form the large and small subunit. They will come together. And then you have the initiated tRNA. The initiated tRNA basically is the tRNA that carries the methionine amino acid. And it also has the initiated tRNA has the anticodon, UAC. Initiated tRNA attached to the start codon, AUG, yes. And then you have the three binding sites, the P site, A site, E site. P site, P in here, it stands for peptide, A stands for amino acid, and then E stands for exit. So what happened is that at first initial TR will look for the AUG sequence on the messenger RNA, you will bind to it, and then the two subunits will come together. When the two subunits come together, then the initiated tRNA will be at the P site. So remember, P site is in between A and B site. The reason is that during elongation step, what happens is that the polypeptide chain will increase in length, of course, but it will increase in length one at a time. Let's go back to this picture. It is easier to look at this picture. So what happened is that a second tRNA will go into this A site, and then the peptide codon will match the codon on the messenger RNA. How did it reach here? You will have the two amino acids carried by the initiator tRNA and the second tRNA. The two amino acids will form the bond, form the peptide bond, and the methionine will be detached from the initiator tRNA. And after this, the two tRNA they will shift. The initiator tRNA will go to the E site, the second tRNA here will go from A site to P site. As soon as the initiator tRNA reach the E site, then you will leave the E site, and then a third tRNA will go into the A site, and then the entire sequence will repeat, so that the amino acid chain can keep on increasing the length. So this is what it means in here. One thing. The elongation occurs one amino acid at a time because we only have one A site, one P site, and one E site, so you can only have one amino acid going into the ribosome each time. And then in here, we have something called elongation factors. Elongation factors, they are proteins. Those elongation factor protein, because it helps the binding of the tRNA. The anticodon on the tRNA, when it binds to the codon of the messenger RNA, it requires these proteins to help them to do it. And the elongation has four steps. The first step is that the tRNA that has the peptide, they are in the P site, that's why we call it peptide site. And the tRNA carries, the new tRNA that goes, that carries the next amino acid, it will go into the A site. A site, they call it amino acid site, or you can call it arriving, it arrives at the A site. And then, when the new tRNA is at A site, then the polypeptide chain will be transferred to this new tRNA, and we can look at this picture here. So the P site is where the polypeptide is joined here, and then we have the tRNA. It will go to the A site, and then after the new tRNA go to the A site, then you have this joint go into here. Polypeptide will go into this, will form the peptide bond with the new amino acid. After this, the two will shift, will move one step forward. This amino acid this tRNA that no longer has the amino acid or polypeptide chain will go into the E site exercise so that it can leave. And then this so-called the new one will occupy the P site and wait for the next tRNA to go to the A site. And then the entire sequence will repeat itself. high energy in the elongation steps because energy is needed to form the peptide bond. Remember, peptide bond is a special form of a covalent bond. The covalent bond stores energy, which is something that we talked about at the beginning of the semester. When we break the covalent bond, we release the energy stored in the covalent bond, and the energy stored in the covalent can be used for making ATP, which is something that we cover in the cellular respiration lecture. And then we talk about this in the picture already. It just moved one step at a time, so that when the transferrin reach the E site, then it can leave. Termination. Termination is the last step. Termination is the last step. It does not require energy. Why? As the ribosome move along the mRNA, as long as it reaches the sequence, the stop codon sequence, then everything will come apart. The two large and small subunit, they will be separated. The entire polypeptide will be detached, and then the messenger RNA will also be free to go. So the termination occurs at the stop codon. And then they also require some release factor protein to cut the polypeptide from the tRNA. And the ribosome are dissociated into two subunits. So now, as the ribosome move along the messenger RNA and see this UGA stop codon, then everything comes separate, everything comes apart, everything is released. So termination is a very easy step to understand. So this is the overview or review of all the of the entire gene expression of protein synthesis sequences. We start with the DNA, and then transcription occur and make the primary RNA, which has intron in it. Intron, they are the junk sequence. Exon, they are the sequence that contains gene for expression. So we want to remove the intron by the processing step. After intron, they are removed. We have the mature RNA, and then we put the guanine cap on the 5' end and poly A tail on the 3' end. After we remove the intron and cap the both end of the messenger RNA, can go through this nuclear pore on the nuclear envelope to go into the cytoplasm. When the messenger RNA go into the cytoplasm, the first organelle that it reach will should be the rough ER, because rough ER, as I mentioned before, is an extension of the nuclear envelope. So as soon as the messenger RNA leave the nucleus, you have the highest probability, you have the highest chance to reach the rough ER, and also the ribosome attached to the rough ER. And as it reaches the ribosome in the rough ER, then the translation can occur, and then this ribosome will scan for the start codon AUG, so that the first amino acid will be methionine. And as it moves along the messenger RNA, the polypeptide chain will also increase in length through the elongation steps. And then after that, as the ribosome scan the stop codon, if there's a stop codon, then everything will be detached, and the translation or the elongation, the translation will stop. Then we will have the free floating, we have the polypeptide chain made. So that is the end of today's lecture. I will definitely ask you a question from the slides on Wednesday. And if you have any question about this online lecture, please feel free to ask me during the Wednesday lecture as well. Thank you.